I'm Rebecca Westerfield, and it's my great pleasure to introduce to you our guest tonight. Jameel Jaffer is the director of the Knight First Amendment Institute at Columbia University and the former deputy legal director of the American Civil Liberties Union. While at the ACLU, Jameel successfully led the legal team that secured the release of the documents underlying the United States government's framework for drone strikes. These documents were recently published in the book Drone Memos, Targeted Killing, Secrecy, and the Law, which Jameel edited and introduced. Listed as one of Foreign Policy Magazine's top 100 global thinkers, Jameel is regarded as one of the more prominent commentators and speakers on issues relating to civil liberties and human rights. For those of you here tonight, I direct you to a more robust bio of Jameel that's in your material. Please join me in welcoming Jameel Jaffer for a conversation about his book, The Drone Memos. Thank you, Jameel. Jameel, I'd like to start the conversation by your sharing some of your experience in representing the family of Anwar al-Awlaki, and perhaps you could tell us how you got involved in that case and what that case was about.
Sure. So first, thanks for inviting me. Really pleased to be here this evening. So I represented the family of Anwar al-Awlaki, who was an American who was killed in a drone strike in Yemen in 2011. And before we started representing his family, we had filed some transparency litigation in New York and in Washington, trying to get more information about the policies that the Obama administration had put in place relating to drone strikes. And we were litigating those cases, and just after we started litigating the first of those cases, the New York Times and the Washington Post published some stories indicating that the administration had added Anwar al-Awlaki, this American citizen, to so-called kill lists, one maintained by the CIA and another one maintained by military special forces, JSOC. And this was it was immediately obvious this was an unusual thing to have an American targeted by his own government in this way. It turns out to have been the first time since at least the Civil War that the U.S. government announced the targeting of a specific American citizen. And we were asking questions about the constitutionality of these policies, and we were not getting answers from the administration. And we were contacted by a human rights group in Yemen, and in May of 2010, I went to Sana'a, capital of Yemen, with a colleague, Ben Wisner, who has since become famous for representing Snowden, but he and I went to Yemen to meet with Nasser al-Awlaki, the father of Anwar. And Nasser's a very interesting figure because he spent a lot of time in the United States. He got his PhD here. He taught economics at a couple of different universities here, had a lot of ties in the United States and a lot of affection for the United States and for the people he had met here. But he asked us when we got there, he said, how can this possibly be lawful, to target somebody for death without ever presenting evidence to any court? And we didn't have a good answer for him. And so when we came back to the United States, we started putting together this case with the Center for Constitutional Rights, another human rights group in New York, putting together this case challenging the lawfulness of the framework that the administration had put in place. So that's how that's how it started.
So can you talk to us without getting too much into the details, talk to us about what is the foundational legal framework for target killing through through drones?
Well, so this is one of the big questions. The most controversial question is which framework applies to drone strikes carried out away from conventional battlefields. So everybody agrees that drone strikes carried out in places like Iraq or Afghanistan, where the United States is or was at war, on conventional battlefields, those kinds of strikes are governed by the laws of war, by international humanitarian law, which gives state actors more latitude. If you're at war on a conventional battlefield, you have more latitude to use lethal force. The question becomes controversial when the government is carrying out these strikes not on conventional battlefields, but in places that it concedes are outside zones of actual hostility. So places like Yemen and Somalia, which exist in this kind of in-between world, which are not conventional battlefields, but nonetheless places where the United States uses lethal force against perceived enemies. You know, what framework governs those strikes? And the argument that we made in court was that those strikes should be governed by the human rights framework, which is much more stringent and allows for the use of lethal force when somebody presents a truly imminent threat and when the use of lethal force is a last resort. But outside those relatively narrow circumstances, lethal force isn't available to a state actor. And that was one of the questions, maybe the big question that was presented in the cases that we brought.
Mm-hmm. And what was the result?
So we filed two different cases. Mm-hmm. The result was the same in both cases, which is that we got thrown out at the threshold, but the details are a little bit different. So in the first case, a judge in New York, a judge in D.C. held that the political question doctrine insulated the issue from judicial review. In other words, the judge said the question of whether a particular person is a legitimate target in an armed conflict is a question committed to the political branches. In other words, a question that the judges don't have a role in answering. And after Judge John Bates issued that decision at the end of 2010, the United States carried out several attempts on Anwar al-Awlaki's life, and eventually in September of 2011, he was killed in a drone strike along with another American citizen, Samir Khan, who hadn't been targeted but was traveling with him. And then 3 weeks after that, another drone strike 400 miles away from the first one killed Anwar al-Awlaki's 16-year-old son, also an American citizen. And after those two strikes that killed three Americans, we went back to court arguing that even if the courts didn't have a role to play before a strike was carried out, they surely had a role to play after a strike was carried out in evaluating whether the strike had been carried out in compliance with the relevant domestic and international law. And there the judge, a different judge, said remedies that are available in other contexts aren't available in this national security context. And she said essentially the same thing that Judge Bates had said a few months earlier, which is that the courts don't have a role to play in evaluating the lawfulness of these strikes.
So there's no judicial oversight, there's no check or balance in any way on these executive decisions?
I think that that's a fairly accurate characterization of the lay of the land. But let me give you the other side, because if there was somebody from the government here, they would disagree. So what the government would say, or at least what the Obama administration would have said, is that there are lots of checks and balances, but the checks and balances are inside the executive branch. We deliberate about who should be put on these lists and whether any particular strike should be carried out. We take that role, that job, very seriously. We evaluate after the fact whether strikes were appropriate or not. We take into account the risk to civilians. And we have put in place a set of rules ourselves to ensure that the risk to civilians isn't greater than it should be, and to ensure that the people we're targeting are the right people. That's what they would say. All of those checks are within the executive branch. They're a set of rules that were written by executive branch actors, and the compliance of the executive branch with those rules is evaluated by executive branch actors. Congress does play a role as well, but not in evaluating the lawfulness of strikes. That's not a role that Congress has ever played. Congress evaluates, to some extent, the effectiveness of the of the program, and it assesses the political wisdom of the program, and that's largely the intelligence committees. But outside that, there's nothing else.
So Presidents Ford, Carter, and Reagan adhered to an executive order, it's 12333, which prohibited assassinations. How does this differ from assassinations?
Well, the argument that the Obama administration made was that assassinations, by definition, are unlawful killings, and we think these killings are lawful, so they're not assassinations. That was, in fact, their argument. I know it sounds funny, but it you know, I'm stating it almost verbatim. At the end of the day, the executive order is yet another set of executive branch rules. So, you know, they could always change the executive order, right? So even if that is we've found that out, right? Even if that they saw that executive order as a bar, they could have changed the executive order. The real concern is not that it violates, that these kinds of strikes violate the executive order, but that they violate, or at least the real legal concern, so they violate domestic and international law. The idea that you can kill an American, this is in some ways the easiest question presented here, right? You can kill an American without ever having to present evidence to a judge, let alone to the public, but ever having to account for your actions to a judge. To me, that always seemed like it couldn't possibly be the right answer. Obviously, judges disagreed.
So some of these internal, I think Harold Coe, who was charged with identifying certain targeted individuals, talked about robust procedures within the executive branch. Do we know what those procedures are? Are they wrapped
in
secrecy?
Well, now we do have some idea what the procedures are. There was a set of rules that the administration put in place in May of 2013. In response to human rights groups' concerns about some of the strikes that have been carried out before that, in response to some of the reporting about some of the strikes that have been carried out before that, they put this relatively stringent set of rules in place in 2013. Through something called the Presidential Policy Guidance. And that guidance says that they won't carry out strikes unless there's a near certainty that civilians won't be killed. They won't carry out a strike unless the target presents a continuing and imminent threat. And they won't carry out a strike unless the use of lethal force is a last resort. So that set of rules is relatively stringent. At least on its face, it's relatively stringent. But they adopted that set of rules as a matter of policy. They didn't accept that they were legally required to adopt that set of rules. And they adopted that set of rules only in places that they regarded to be outside conventional battlefields. So there were some places like in Pakistan, for example, where they didn't implement that set of rules. But more importantly, they adopted it as a matter of policy, which means that it can be lifted as a matter of policy. It's yet another set of executive branch rules that another president could change.
And do we have any recent indications on what the current administration is doing with regards to these policies?
We do have some because there was a drone strike. A strike carried out in Yemen 10 days ago that killed just under a dozen civilians. And while the Trump administration has not announced any departure from the Obama administration's rules, the fact that that operation killed so many civilians suggests that they are drifting away, at least, from the rules that the Obama administration adopted in 2013.
So as you've studied this issue of drone killings and strikes, what do folks in the national security world say about their impact?
Depends who you mm-hmm. talk to. So I think overall, it's easy to find people who will say that the drone program is necessary and effective at a tactical level. Meaning, if you know that there's somebody planning an attack in Yemen or in Somalia, a drone strike is an appealing tool to have at your disposal. And I don't think they can point to specific attacks that would have been carried out but for drone strikes, but they can point to successes in the sense of people who they regarded to be truly dangerous who were eliminated by drone strikes. And so that's, you can find people very easily to say that the program is successful at that, effective at that level. It's much harder to find people who are willing to say that the program is effective at the level of strategy, that, you know, over time, this is a program that has made us safer. And, you know, to the contrary, many senior national security officials or former senior national security officials have said that the program has generated more enemies than it's eliminated. And, you know, all of these strikes that, you know, you don't have to be a military expert to understand that, you know, any strike that ends up killing civilians or even not killing civilians, but killing somebody who is associated with, you know, Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, every one of those strikes, even if it ends up killing somebody who is hostile to the United States, generates another set of people who are hostile to the United States. So, you know, overall, this kind of analysis is full of counterfactuals. It's always, you know, impossible to know what would have happened had we not had a drone program. But if you look at the number of people who are associated with Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula in 2010, so when we first started litigating the Anwar al-Awlaki case, there were about 200 people thought to be associated with Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. And I saw just a couple months ago a New York Times story that said there were 1,100 members of Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula in one city in southern Yemen alone. Now, I don't want to say that it's because of the drone program that, you know, that happened, but anyone who wants to defend the effectiveness of that program has to be able to explain why, in spite of the program, these groups have grown so dramatically.
I thought in your book, The Drone Memos, you also describe just the impact of having the drone technology in the geographic area of a population and the terror that created. Could you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, there. You know, this is something that, you know, it's easy not to realize, but. A drone, when a drone is hovering over, you know, a village, it has an effect on everybody in that village, not just the person who's ultimately the target of the drone strike. And there's a really important and powerful report that was done. There were two of them, one done by Stanford, another one done by students at NYU, where they interviewed people from places in which the United States had been using armed drones. And they just talked to people who lived in these, you know, in these communities about the effect that the drones had on their daily lives. And people live in a state of terror because they hear the drones above their heads. They hear the buzz of the drones. They occasionally see the drones. And nobody ever knows when a drone is going to launch a hellfire missile into, you know, into a particular house. And you know, it's hard to quantify or know what to do with that, you know, with that cost of this kind of program. But it's, I think it's important to realize that, you know, when people say these are targeted weapons, that they, you know, in the sense that they affect only the person, you know, who is killed, they're not targeted. You know, their effects are very broad, and you know, people suffer real physical and psychological harms because of the drones that hover over their heads.
So is there anyone addressing this looping effect? We're using the drones to stop terrorism, yet the use of the drones themselves may actually encourage terrorism.
One of the frustrations that human rights groups have had is that the government hasn't produced any document like that. There hasn't been any serious study, at least not one that has been publicly discussed, of the strategic effectiveness of the drone program. The Stimson Center in D.C. has been, you know, very vocally calling for precisely that kind of study for at least, you know, 5 years now, and to my knowledge, no efforts have been made in that direction.
Have any efforts been made in Congress? Is there anyone leading that discussion in Congress at this juncture?
No, there was briefly in 2012 an effort to Senator Feinstein actually said that she would hold hearings about the necessity of a drone court. Mm-hmm. So I think that a lot of people on the left and right felt like there was something, you know, sort of shared by instinct that it couldn't be right that the government could carry out this kind of strike and never have to defend it. But that effort really didn't go anywhere, and there was really just a moment in 2012, and then again in 2013, where it seemed possible that Congress would do something, but they didn't. I guess one thing I should say is that, you know, I think legally the easiest questions have to do with U.S. citizens, you know, because it's just indisputable that U.S. citizens have rights under the Fifth Amendment, and you know, if there's you know, any circumstance in which you would think that due process would have some content, it would be this kind of circumstance where the government was using lethal force. But the vast majority of people who are killed in drone strikes are not American citizens, right? They're foreigners, and there was never any interest on the part of Congress to provide family members of foreigners killed in drone strikes judicial redress. That just wasn't even offered as a possibility.
Do we know what the criteria is for getting on this targeted list?
Well, we know at the level at a high level of mm-hmm. generality. So we know those rules that the administration adopted, the Obama administration adopted in May, the imminent mm-hmm. threat, near certainty that no civilians will be killed. Those rules we know, but we don't know how those rules are applied in practice. And you know, with rules stated at that level of generality, all the action is in how they're applied in mm-hmm. practice. And you know, one of the reasons we sued for, so when we brought these transparency suits, we asked for the Justice Department memos that provided the basis for these drone strikes. We asked for statistical information about the number of civilians who had been killed in these drone strikes, but we also asked for the factual basis for the strike that had killed Anwar al-Awlaki. We said we want to know why you decided to target this particular American citizen. And you know, there were all these allegations in the press about his involvement in terrorist attacks. His operational involvement was the phrase that the government used. And the allegations were very serious allegations. They, you know, if the allegations were true, you would understand why the government saw this person as such a serious threat. But they were just allegations in the press, and usually attributed to anonymous officials. It struck us as indefensible that the government would try to defend an action like this on the basis of anonymous allegations to the media. And so we sued for the factual basis for the strike. We said, you know, tell us why you decided to give us a formal, you know, the formal explanation, what you would have included in an indictment had you indicted him. Give us that explanation for why you carried out this strike. We asked for, you know, the evidence that they relied on, and the administration refused to provide that evidence, citing intelligence sources and methods, saying that we can't disclose our intelligence sources and methods. But because they didn't disclose that information, it's hard to know. There's a lot of distance between these abstract rules and the application of those rules in practice, and it's hard to know how those rules actually operate when so little of the factual information is disclosed.
So drone strikes on U.S. soil, that hasn't occurred yet. Would that still be a political question that the courts would stay away from?
That's a good question. I think that if you accept the legal reasoning of these two judges at face value, then what would matter is whether the strikes were carried out for national security reasons in the context of an armed conflict. So you could take Judge Bates's decision or Judge Cotelli's decision, which is the second judge, and just sort of apply them in the United States. I wonder whether judges would actually do that. I think it would surprise me if judges adopted that same framework for drone strikes inside the United States.
What framework would they substitute?
Well, it's already something that judges do all the time in the United States. They evaluate the lawfulness of the government's use of lethal force in the context of police police operations, right? If somebody's running down the street waving a gun around, the police don't go to a judge beforehand to ask for permission to use lethal force. But after they use lethal force, they're called to account for their actions in court. There's an excessive force claim, and when that claim is made, the police have to present the evidence or present their rationale for the use of lethal force. So that framework exists. It's nothing, it's not foreign to the American courts. And that was the framework we were asking them to apply here too. We were saying, evaluate the lawfulness of this conduct that the government engaged in last week. You know, just like you do in police with respect to police operations. But I assume that's the framework they would apply if the government carried out a drone strike inside the United States.
So we're collecting questions from members of the audience here. And so one question is, what effect will the Obama administration's drone policy have on international law? What precedent does it set for other countries with drone technology, such as Russia and China?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's a great question. The United States is not the only country that has this technology. Several other countries now have armed drones, and many countries are, using drones in other ways, and could use armed drones if they wanted to. And many non-state actors now, including terrorist groups, have access to primitive armed drones. So the framework that we have adopted here will be used by other countries. And I think it's probably just a matter of time before you see, China or India or Pakistan, using armed drones and citing the Obama administration's legal theories. In fact, the UK did carry out a strike in Syria, killing one of its own citizens, The legal memo, the legal analysis that they released was essentially photocopied from the Obama administration's legal memos.
Is the media covering this as much as you would expect?
You know, I think that there was a lot of coverage of the Anwar al-Awlaki killing. One thing, you know, we filed those cases knowing that they would be hard to win. We filed them in part because we felt like there wasn't a public, there wasn't sufficient public attention to the policies, and that the case, we thought the cases would generate a public debate, and they did. You know, the big reservation I have about the debate that was sparked by those cases was that the debate was almost entirely about U.S. citizens, right? It was about the government's targeting of U.S. citizens, which again is, you know, is in some ways a uniquely important question, at least from the lens of a lawyer's lens. But in the larger scheme of things, again, you know, Americans, there have been, I think, 7 Americans now killed through drone strikes. Only one of them was targeted. The others were killed in the course of strikes directed at other people. But even, you know, 7 Americans compared to 4,000 non-Americans. So I wish that the debate had been broader than the debate that we were able to spark. But the other problem with this is that it's very hard for reporters to get to these places where the drone strikes are taking place, and very few reporters have actually managed to spend any significant amount of time in Yemen or in Somalia talking to people who live in the areas where the drones are operating. There have been a handful of reporters. Jeremy Scahill is one. Michelle Shepard at the Toronto Star is another. You know, who've done really, really important reporting around this this set of policies. But it's relatively rare that you see in the American media accounts of eyewitnesses or survivors of these strikes. And I think the distance and the nature of those and the situation on the ground in those places makes it difficult for reporters to get there, and that means that we don't often have access to the stories.
One of the questioners is asking about Jeremy Shill's book, The Assassination Complex, and wondering how your book is different, and perhaps you might talk a little bit more about Jeremy's book as well.
So that book, Assassination Complex, is based on a set of leaks that The Intercept got a couple of years ago. And they're fascinating documents that are collected in that book. But they're documents about at the level of that, sort of the ground level, about how these rules are implemented in individual operations. The documents that I collected are in some ways sort of the counterpart to that set of documents. They're policy documents and legal documents. The documents in my book are the really the legal justifications for the drone program, or the ostensible legal justifications for the drone program, and the very high level rules that the Obama administration put in place to govern drone strikes. So, you know, you can think of these documents as the legal framework, and the documents collected in the Assassination Complex as the implementation of the framework on the ground.
Your predictions going forward with regards to these programs?
So if there's one central argument in my introduction to the book, is that we invested all of this power in the presidency because we trusted the president. At some level, Americans trusted Obama to use these powers wisely. And I think that's why we were willing to give him all of that power, and that's why the courts said we're okay with the political branches making these decisions. I think that instinct was a short-sighted instinct, that we, you know, we invested all this power in the presidency because we assumed that the powers would be used wisely, and we didn't sufficiently take into account the possibility that another president at some point would have a different perspective on the world than President Obama, and that another president might put in place a different set of rules or apply the rules differently. We just didn't take that into account. When I say we, I mean all of us, but I fault especially the courts, because I think, you know, it really is the court's job to say to the, when the Obama administration came to court and said, trust us, we thought hard before we did this, it's the court's role to say, first, we're not going to trust you, and second, even if we did trust you, we might not trust the next guy. And they didn't. So for that reason, I think, you know, it would be entirely appropriate to worry about what might be done with these powers now. These are very broad powers that aren't subject to the kinds of checks and balances that you ordinarily expect in American democracy. And they are now available to a president who sees the world very differently than President Obama did. I don't want to suggest that President Obama, that I'm, you know, comfortable with the way President Obama used these powers. I'm not. I think that especially in the first few years of his first term, drones were used in a way that I think is sort of indefensible from a human rights perspective, and I suspect was strategically counterproductive as well.
Could you give some examples of that?
Well, yeah, sure. There are, you know, the very first drone strikes that President Obama approved killed many civilians. I think one of them killed over a dozen civilians. There was a strike that Obama authorized in a couple strikes that he authorized in Yemen that killed over two dozen civilians. And those kinds of strikes, I can't prove any of this, but I suspect that those strikes probably made us less safe rather than more safe. And even if they didn't, they're just unjustifiable morally to use lethal force in that way. So I also think that the failure to provide an on-the-record explanation for especially the strike that killed the 16-year-old American, Abdulrahman al-Awlaki, 3 weeks after his father had been killed, I think the failure to provide an on-the-record explanation for that strike is also indefensible. So I don't want to suggest that President Obama, used these powers wisely, but I do think that he surrounded himself with people who took this responsibility seriously. I think that they did come to realize that civilian casualties leading more people to join terrorist groups and increasing hostility against the United States. And they did put in place in 2013 this relatively stringent set of rules, and I think they made a real effort to comply with that set of rules. They at the very least took seriously the obligation to avoid unnecessary civilian casualties. I don't assume that President Trump will take those obligations as seriously, and even if he did, who knows what the next president will do. And I think that those are the kinds of questions that we should have been asking 3, 4, and 5 years ago, and at the very least the court should have been asking 3, 4, and 5 years ago, and they weren't.
So you're calling for a more robust role on the part of the judges the courts. Is it too late?
It's not too late, but the courts will have to take a very different approach now than they have over the last few years. If these powers are going to be subjected to any meaningful oversight, because there are these decisions out there now saying that these powers are essentially beyond the reach of the courts. They're both district court decisions, so they don't bind other courts. They'll have persuasive power, but other judges could go in a different direction. I think that it's possible that the new administration won't get the same reception from judges as the last administration did, precisely because, because President Trump talks about these powers very differently than President Obama did. It's possible that the judges will be more skeptical, will ask more questions, will force the government to disclose more information. All of that is possible, but it remains to be seen whether they will summon the courage and energy to do that.
Well, let me change the topic a bit. And draw on you as a former deputy counsel to the American Civil Liberties Union. It's interesting that, of course, today here in San Francisco are arguments before the Ninth Circuit with regards to the Trump travel ban. Do you have any thoughts or predictions with regards to what the appellate courts will do on the travel ban and the immigration issues?
No predictions, but so a lot of these cases, a lot of these national security cases have turned on the degree of deference that the courts have been willing to extend to the executive branch, right? And as a matter of course, over the last 8 years, and maybe even over the last 15 years, the courts deferred to executive branch claims relating to national security. So over and over again, President Bush and then President Obama said, this policy is necessary for national security. And the courts said, essentially, well, if you say so. And my complaint in this book is largely about that practice on the part of the courts. But when they have deferred to the executive branch, the executive branch has at least been able to say that it considered the necessity of these policies, that there was some process within the executive branch, some sensible process that involved a consideration of the threat, a consideration of the appropriate response to the threat, a consideration to whether the response was narrowly tailored to the threat. And the courts ultimately deferred to the executive branch, but the executive branch could say, we thought seriously about it, and this is the answer we came up with. I think what we're seeing now is that the Trump administration can't even make that claim. The Trump administration can't claim that the decision to, ban citizens from these seven, ban Muslims from these seven countries was the result of a sensible process within the executive branch. It doesn't seem to have been the result of a process within the executive branch at all. And I wonder whether the courts will extend the same level of respect and deference to this decision, given that the executive branch can't make the kinds of representations that it's been able to make in other cases.
What do you attribute the reluctance, this is a question from the audience, what do you attribute the reluctance of Congress to question the strategic efficacy of the drone program?
I think that I'm not sure I have a full answer to that, question. But part of the answer has to do with incentives. Nobody wants the responsibility. Nobody wants to be held responsible for narrowing these powers. Because if you narrow these powers, even if it was a good idea to narrow these powers, then the next time there's a terrorist attack, somebody's going to point to you and say, well, you're the one who narrowed these powers. And you know, politicians are worried about elections, and so it takes a degree of political courage to ask questions about the necessity of these kinds of powers, and not a lot of politicians seem to have that courage.
Which federal agencies are consulted before a drone strike?
I don't know the answer to that question now. So essentially there were two different programs under the Obama administration, one run by the military, another one run by the CIA. And they had different processes. They overlapped to some extent because in some circumstances they shared intelligence before the drone strikes. But they were really two separate programs. And then the Justice Department also became involved when U.S. citizens were the targets. More recently, there was an effort to consolidate the drone program within the military, to get the CIA out of the business of using lethal force, although the CIA would still provide intelligence to the military, which was then relied on in these kinds of strikes. That transition from the CIA to the military was never fully, was never completed. And it's unclear to me what role the CIA is playing now in the drone program. A lot of people felt like the transition to the military was good, at least from the perspective of transparency. The military was likely to be more transparent about its activities. It was accustomed to accounting to the public for its actions in a way that the CIA wasn't. So a lot of human rights groups felt that the transition to the military, you know, if we were going to be carrying out these kinds of drone strikes, it was better if the military did it than if the CIA did it. But that transition never fully happened, and I don't know what the Trump administration intends to do.
I think you've mentioned other countries of Britain, for instance, who's used drone strikes. Have other countries used drone strikes that we're aware of?
Israel has, and the UK has. There was a strike that China contemplated. This was about 2 years ago. They were going to carry out a strike in another country. I'm sorry, I'm forgetting that which country it was, but they were going to carry out a strike in another country, somebody associated with or thought to be associated with drug trafficking. But they managed to capture that person and so never carried out the strike. I'm not sure any other country has carried out drone strikes.
So again, I'm going to move things to a different subject. You're at the Knight Institute for the First Amendment, as I understand it. What issues are you all dealing with?
Well,
what's on your plate?
Yeah, so the Institute was set up to mm-hmm. tackle big issues relating to the First Amendment in the digital age. Mm-hmm. So that covers everything from free speech on social media, to government transparency, to the free speech implications of government surveillance. The Institute was set up a year ago, before, you know, the political, before the election, and so now the landscape is, you know, quite different, and there are many urgent threats to the First Amendment that we didn't expect to have to address. And so now, I think it's likely we'll certainly address those deeper issues that we had, you know, intended to address. But there are also issues relating to the right to protest, the speech of government employees. When can government employees speak publicly about their disagreement with government policy? The rights of whistleblowers, source protection for journalists who are subpoenaed for their for the names of their sources, issues relating to surveillance of religious groups or, you know, mosques, that's something that the Trump administration has already made clear it wants to do. Those kinds of issues, which some of those issues might have arisen whoever the president was, but some of them are presented more urgently than I expected them to be, and we'll tackle those. Even people have talked a lot about the First Amendment implications of the Muslim ban, but they've talked mainly about the Establishment Clause, whether that ban violates the Establishment Clause. There are also questions about the effects.
Could you describe the Establishment Clause for some?
The First Amendment prohibits the government from establishing religion, right? From establishing a religion. And the theory here is that the favoring of some religions over others is a form of establishment. That's the theory that some people are arguing in relation to the Muslim ban. But there's another set of First Amendment issues relating to travel bans like this, because travel bans like this deprive all of us of the opportunity to meet with and talk to people from other countries. And that effect of these kinds of travel bans is an effect that that the courts have recognized as important to as implicating the First Amendment. There's a long line of Supreme Court case there's one Supreme Court case and a long line of appellate court cases recognizing that travel bans like this implicate the Free Speech Clause. And so that set of issues too, I think we will have to address.
So after the election, I believe the American Civil Liberties Union reported that it had an enormous increase in contributions. And one member of the audience wants to know, what is the Civil Liberties Union going to be doing with that?
Well, I don't work there anymore, so this is something that I was at the ACLU for 14 years, and from 2002 to 2016. And I think that it's an extremely effective organization, and that if you're thinking about if these are issues that matter to you, and you're thinking about where you can give money, a place that'll use your support effectively. I have no hesitation in recommending the ACLU. I think it's an amazing group of people, a really effective group of advocates, I think that they will put those resources to good use.
I think folks are feeling there are so many different issues, so many fronts to address with the speed that this administration has started out with in terms of overturning executive orders and moving forward on so many different fronts. If you were to have a list of priorities what is your greatest concern, say the top five,
wow.
Since we can't do it all.
I think that the immigration orders are, I think that people are right to be so upset and outraged by the immigration orders, not just for what they are, but for what they represent. They really send a particular message about the United States. They convey a message that, in my mind, is completely contrary to the message that we ought to be sending to the world and to each other about the place of the United States in the world. And so I think that people are right to focus their energies on those executive orders. I worked mainly on issues relating to national security, so I that's where my focus tends to be. I'm worried about what the administration will do with Guantanamo. The Obama administration made a lot of progress in reducing the population at Guantanamo, but the prison is still there. There are still several dozen men held there, and there are people in the new administration who seem to be enthusiastic about repopulating Guantanamo, so I'm very worried about that. I think that the drone policies are something to keep an eye on. You know, I think that the last administration claimed very broad powers, and the new administration will use those broad powers very aggressively. Government surveillance is something else to, if you want something else to worry about, you can worry about that too. There's going to be a very significant fight in Congress over the next 11 months over something called the FISA Amendments Act of 2008, which is the law that Congress passed to ratify the Bush administration's warrantless wiretapping program, and that law is set to expire at the end of this year. And the Trump administration, I'm sure, will want that law to be reauthorized and possibly even expanded. But there are some in Congress who have suggested that they won't vote for an extension of that law unless the law is modified in important ways, narrowed in important ways. So I think that's another issue that is likely to be in the news over the next year. And then, you know, as I mentioned, the use of these surveillance powers on minority communities, Muslims, but also on aimed at all these new protest movements, including the Black Lives Matter movement. I worry about the way that the new administration will use those kinds of surveillance powers.
Do you have any comments on Gorsuch, the nominee to the Supreme Court?
I don't know enough about him to have comments.
You have any?
Sorry.
That's all right. Yeah. What do you expect the Supreme Court to be looking at in the next couple of years?
Well, one thing about Gorsuch is he seems to, you know, based on the small number of opinions he's written about the First Amendment, he seems to have a broad view of the First Amendment, and you know, that is in many ways, I think, a good thing. Although, you know, one thing that has I think one set of issues that the Supreme Court is likely to have to deal with this term and next term and for the next few years is the status of commercial speech under the First Amendment. And you know, many people who have a broad view of the First Amendment now have the view that commercial speech shouldn't be treated any differently than political speech under the First Amendment. And the effect of that view is to make it harder for the government to regulate in the area of, for example, in the area of privacy. So if you, there are going to be these kinds of conflicts, or at least tensions, between the freedom of speech and the right to privacy. And those are hard, really hard questions, at least in my view. They're really hard questions. And the fact that Gorsuch has such a broad view of free speech may be a good thing, you know, if you're narrowly focused on the First Amendment. But if you're thinking about civil liberties more generally, it's more complicated.
And he also, as I understand it, is a states' rights proponent. We know Justice Brennan developed a theory of preserving individual rights under state constitutions rather than federal constitutions. Do you think that there may be a place there for Gorsuch to step in and support the state interpretations of their own constitutions?
Yeah, I think that you're right about that. You know, in thinking through what your attitude ought to be about Gorsuch, you kind of have to think about, well, if not him, then who, right? And you know, some of the people who were proposed as alternatives to Gorsuch, I think, had even stronger views about states' rights. So, you know, whether Gorsuch turns out to be a good justice or not, or whether he should be confirmed or not, you know, I don't have a position on those questions, but I do think it's worth thinking about, you know, who's next in line if he's not the one who gets confirmed.
And who would you be watching in Congress to help bridge some of the division that we see in Congress over some of these issues of human rights?
You know, one of the really great things that happened over the last few years is, you know, in this era of polarization, there was this strange alliance between some progressives in Congress and some libertarians. And you saw that for a little while on the drone issue, at least with respect to the targeting of Americans. And you saw it again on surveillance issues with the USA Freedom Act in the summer of 2015. And I don't know what's going to happen to that coalition now under this new administration, whether the lines have shifted enough that coalition will fall apart. But I think that it was that coalition that made possible some of the transparency around the drone program, and it was that coalition that made possible the reforms in the USA Freedom Act. There were modest reforms, but they were still reforms. And if there are reforms to the FISA Amendments Act at the end of this year, I think it'll be because of that coalition.
Thank you. Jameel Jaffer, we really appreciate your time this evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.